We all love Pixar. If you don't, then you probably didn't click on this video. My question is, could the movie tie-in games of these beloved Pixar movies be better than the movie? To judge this, I have developed a very complicated scoring system similar to the likes of Legends, RuPaul, and Dumbledore, where the criteria is, whatever I say goes, and there's nothing you can do about it. Except, of course, yell at me in the comments. Please feel free to do that. First up, Monsters, Inc., one of Pixar's greats. It's a fun, original concept that created awesome moments and has tons of heart. It's quotable, it has memorable characters who have now even become iconic. It's great. I give it 9 screen canisters out of 10. It's a pretty high score to beat. Let's see if the games can do it. So already, quick sidebar, I didn't know that they actually made 4 different versions of the game. I played the PC version back in the day and remembered enjoying it as a child. The game had you doing a variety of factory type minigames, filing paperwork, filling up screen canisters, and even parking cars. Yeah, I thought this was fun. It was literally my first PC game I ever played. Then there's Monsters, Inc. Scream Teen or Monsters, Inc. Scareland, depending on the region. This came out for the PS1 and is a platformer that serves as a prequel taking place right after Monsters University, but I didn't play that one. But if you did and have any fond memories about it, please feel free to tell me about it in the comments. But the one I did play was a GameCube one, thinking it had to be the best one, well, because it's for the GameCube. Monsters, Inc. Scream Arena. Scream Arena is like a Mario Dodgeball minigame. Literally, that's it. That's the whole game. Why dodgeball? I don't know. I don't even remember them playing dodgeball in the movie. I don't know what they were thinking, but minus points for weak concept. You start off with a handful of characters you can choose from, and they're basically skins anyway. None of them have any sorts of special abilities or anything. They're purely cosmetic. Minus points for laziness. You can use your ball to block high and low, and the longer you hold down the throw button, the harder and faster it goes. Then there's a last man standing, where you have to hold on to a special ball for the longest time, or even have the most hits before time runs out. It's a very generic dodgeball-like game. You have a little boost to run away, and that's basically it. It's not compelling in the least, minus points. Not only super easy because, well, it's for kids, but also the computer barely does anything. They add a few more opponents in the later levels, but I was able to win multiple games without even getting hit once. There are different powered balls, at least. There's sticky balls, bubble balls, yo-yo balls, just to name a few. But yeah, this game sucks. They even do the same intro over and over again when you start the same level. No points. You unlock more characters and more locations from the movie, but the game just sucks some major balls, no pun intended. The gameplay isn't rewarding at all, and the rounds feel so long that anything over 30 seconds just feel like forever. There's only one positive from this game, and it's the music. It's great. It carries the same vibe that the movie does, so musical points. They definitely did Nintendo dirty with this one. I feel like it might be more fun with friends, but since I don't have any, we'll be moving on. I will give this 2 Scream canisters out of 10. Scream Arena was so bad, it made me track down the PS2 version of the game. This is just titled Monsters, Inc., which is totally different. Why did they do that? I don't know. This one follows the movie and even uses scenes from the movie as cutscenes. We control Sulley in 8 main levels and you can even unlock 5 more. There are a handful of things that you can collect in each level to unlock movies and the bonus levels. Gameplay consists of platforming around, trying to retrieve something for someone, or just finding the exit. You can talk to characters that are just walking around and they even offer you some hints on what to do on top of the already hint-heavy markers. But the fact that you can interact with the monsters that are just walking around is kind of cool. Bonus points for talking. Sulley can scare to flip switches, he can push boxes to climb on higher ground, and he can climb ladders. Very, very slowly. He can dash, and he also has a tail whip attack to break boxes for the collectibles or even attack CDA bots. You have a health bar that you can recover by eating snacks. There are no lives, but there are checkpoints, so if you're caught by the CDA or fall off the level, they just kind of bring you back to the checkpoint and even keep your progress. So I use this to my advantage throughout the game. If I found something that I had to bring back to Mike or somebody, I just got caught on purpose and it saves me a whole trip of getting back. Platforming controls aren't the best. I would say that they're pretty mediocre and at times a tad bit annoying, but the platforming environments are pretty fun. You can jump around conveyor belts, the factory, their apartment, rooftops, and much more. Points for scenery. The camera is complete ass. It feels like you're only able to spin one way half the time. It just feels like it's working against you. Minus points for a drunk camera. Voice acting is really good. The actors did a good job of sounding pretty much like their movie counterparts. This game gave me way more than Scream Arena did, and for that alone, I give it 6 Scream canisters out of 10. Even by combining these scores, these games fall way short to the movie. But Let's just keep swimming over on to the next movie, Finding Nemo. Finding Nemo is my favorite Pixar movie. It's pretty perfect, from voice acting to the sense of adventure to the way you fall in love with each character. It's funny, heartwarming, it's just simply the best. This movie easily gets 10 out of 10 butts. This Nemo, on the other hand, is kind of scary though. Anyway, this game is based on the movie and also uses the movie as cutscenes. Depending on the level, you'll be playing as Nemo, Marlin, or Dory. They all kind of control pretty much the same. There's a boost, an action button that also works as a dash, and the levels follow the movie pretty closely. There are three optional objectives you can complete for stars that you use to unlock bonus levels. You can pick up colored pebbles and place them on their corresponding pedestals. Collecting all the bubble rings is another way to get a star, and defeating all the enemies of the level is another. The bonus levels are simple yet kinda annoying, from match game to simple puzzles to pushing this Luxo ball through rings. This was by far the worst, it was really tough to control the ball. Negative points for bad ball physics. You can pick up krill to use as kinda like armor that they help you when you take a hit. The camera angle changes a lot. The 2D levels are basically find your way to the end solving puzzles. The other front facing cameras for the races, where you have to use boost bubble rings to beat whoever you're racing. Other times the cameras flip and you're doing the chasing, but I didn't like the front facing camera, it was very uncomfortable. There are also levels where you have to hop on things to get across, like the jellyfish or turtles. These have a top down camera angle. So there is a variety of gameplay I really wasn't expecting. It can get choppy when there's too much going on, and it had really long load times, at least it did on the GameCube version. But I'm gonna give it some points for the variety of gameplay. Similar to the PS2 Monsters, Inc., there's also no lives and just checkpoints. But unlike the Monsters, Inc., the music doesn't give me Nemo vibes at all. It's just more generic. Minus points for no Nemo vibes. There are 18 levels plus the bonuses and all the side objectives to complete, so there's a lot of replayability here. It's obviously not a must-play by any means, but it's a solid effort from THQ. I would give it 6 butts out of 10, falling way short from the movie. Next up, The Incredibles, the best Fantastic Four movie we actually have. This is one that I think you start to appreciate more as an adult. It has great music, fun themes, it's an all-around fun adventure. I give it 8.5 Super Suits out of 10. Now, I do think this game has the best chance to be better than the movie, since the theme of the movie is superheroes and translates way better to the video games as an action-adventure game. But off the rip, I wasn't expecting to get heckled by Sam Jackson in the main menu to start the game.
Now, don't go messing with all those
times 2 multiplier for this alone. He also yells at you to do stuff in the first couple missions when you're getting the hang of things, but then he disappears. I did kind of miss him. So negative points for taking my Sam Jackson away. The first level starts off as Mr. Incredible back in the day, and you must stop French supervillain Bon Voyage from completing his bank heist. So you got his henchmen popping up and getting in your way. In the second level, you get to use elastic.
Yeah.
So sorry, but you know, extra points, you know what I mean? Along with their normal attacks and a grab button, Mr. Incredible and Elastigirl have some fun in-credit attacks. Bob has a strong punch and a charge attack, and Helen has a spin attack. She can also turn into a ball and charge at the bad guys as well. She has a longer range, of course. She uses her arms to swing and hang on to things, but this lock-on system for this is kind of wonky and unreliable at times. Minus half point for wonkiness. The henchmen attack pretty much the same with just different skins. You have some bots and guys that are flying around, and even some bad guys with guns, which is I think the reason why this game got a T rating from the ESRB, and it's actually the only Pixar game to do so. At the end of the level, you do get stats, and the calories burn stat got me. Funny points. I also enjoyed that you get to use Chunky Mr. Incredible in a level or two. Level design is okay, at least at first. There's a good variety of things. Unreal stuff, puzzles to kind of solve. There's a handful of bosses as well, but the variety doesn't really continue. Halfway through, it just kind of stops. And the final battle is a copy with added stuff of a battle you had had twice already. And it's those types of battles that just goes on for way too long. And they're also like not easy, which is the reason why I think the game has a T rating. It also goes for the difficulty of the game, because I really don't think younger kids can beat this game. I mean, I struggle with it a lot, so if you underestimate this game, it kind of checks you pretty quick. The last few levels especially. They're tough because on top of tricky platforming, they just throw a ton of enemies at you, and it's even unfair sometimes. Minus points for being annoying! Dash actually has two racing levels that are no joke either. He controls a bit weird, like he glides a bit and he's pretty sensitive, so you have to avoid getting hit. Plus you have to keep an eye out for his boost, because if he overheats, that's a fail. Plus it's a one and done, so if you get hit, that's a fail. And on top of that, you have time to complete it. There are checkpoints along the way, but in certain sections, these can get really tough. The game is linear and goes as the movie goes, but they grossly neglected Violet. I mean, terribly. She only has one solo level and it's pretty weak. She has to sneak around guards and all she can do is run and turn invisible. It's like they completely forgot about her and just threw one level for her real quick. Maybe if they added another level where she's like at school and she has to sneak around class or something, it wouldn't have felt like that. So, minus points for forgetting about Violet. She does team up with Dash for one level where you drive around in the Incredible. That level was okay. I do think the game tries to do too much because even though I commend THQ for having a variety of gameplay mechanics, they don't really excel in any particular one. It's like combat is okay, platforming is okay, the dash levels in my opinion aren't great, the Violet level completely sucks, the Incredible level is okay, boss battles are just too long, the music is great, but the biggest foul that this game commit is that there's no Edna mode or Jack Jack. Minus points for not having the best characters of your movies. But in contrast to what I've played up to this point, it did surprise me here and there. So just for that, I give it 6.5 Super Suits out of 10. Unfortunately, coming up short against the movie. But wait, I got a bonus game. Remember at the end of the Incredibles film when this guy shows up? Well, a year later, after the movie release, they released a game following that story, actually serving as the true sequel of the movie. Well, we still don't know because Homie also appears in Incredibles 2 and they kind of changed that, so who knows what's actually canon. Similar to Sam Jackson heckling you in the movie's game menu, the Underminer voiced by Pixar legend John Ratzenberger is doing the same here, even in the pause menu.
The robots make all their music with rocks! What's that sound? It's the sound of evil!
Extra points for talking. In this game, you play as Frozone and Mr. Incredible, and this can even be played in co-op. You can switch between both characters with a simple press of a button if you are playing solo, which is good because you will be needing each hero to perform different things to be able to progress. Points for easy switching. You can command the other hero to stay put, stay close, and be more aggressive, but if the computer is Frozone, he just kind of punches and rarely ever uses his freezing powers, which piss me off. It's just that the computer AI isn't great. They're way too close to me and literally just walk into danger and get in the way more than they help. And when they should help, they don't. So minus points for dumb AI. Luckily, all this can be solved if you had a friend. So if you, or most likely the computer, gets KO'd, they stay down for 20 seconds and get back up. Not dying and not passing a certain amount of damage are your sub-goals for each level. At the end of the level, if you do that, you're awarded XP to level up. Then you get upgrade points to boost your stats. The upgrades aren't really felt in the gameplay, so minus points for useless points. Frozone can freeze, punch, and do his frozen glide, but not for that long, even with upgrading it all the way. Mr. Incredible just punches and can throw frozen enemies and objects. They both can dodge, and when you defeat an enemy with one of these symbol thingies on its head, you get a super attack, and that's pretty much it. Minus points for repetitive gameplay. This game is definitely more linear than the first. The levels never really open up. It's all about the Underminer and his evil bot lackeys. There is a decent variety of enemies. I just hated anything that shoot these green gunky bullets because they're just annoying, and my friend, the computer, don't help me. Minus points for no help. There are a few boss fights, even though you're fighting the same team sometimes, but honestly, they're not too bad. So, half a point for having boss fights at all. Every level kind of feels the same. They do try to change it up a bit in a few by adding ice, but there's only so much you can do underground, and since the only villain in the game is the Underminer, I get it. And for that same reason, the game is really short. You can easily beat it under 4 hours, and when you do, there are no credits or anything. It just starts up again, which felt really weird. This entire game just feels like old school DLC. They really should have just used the effort for this game to make the other game better. I give this game 5.5 Super Suits out of 10. Alright, we're cruising. Next up is Cars, a movie I enjoyed at the time, but I don't hold it as high regard as the rest of them. Looking back at it now, the way that they balanced each personality of the car is actually really brilliant, but I think it's just okay. I give it 7 out of 10 ka-chows. Quick side note, did anyone else think as a kid this was going to be a movie about the Chevron commercial cars? No? Just me? Okay. The game takes place after the events of the movie, and we play as Lightning McQueen for most of the time. It's a new racing season, and he sets his windshield upon winning the Piston Cup for the very first time. And to help us train, we help out around Radiator Springs. We get awarded stars for everything we do, depending on how well we do them. The activities range from minigames like finding Lizzie's postcards, to tractor tipping as Mater, collecting tires as Luigi's, catching speedsters as the Sheriff, and many more. The other activities are actual races against new and old characters from the film. They're challenges that actually improve gameplay as well, like teaching us how to power slide with Doc, Sarge teaches you how to hop, and you're drinking some weird stuff from Fillmore that gives you the boost. Bonus points for PEDs! Later on, Chick starts messing with us, having the Fast and Furious guys from the movie steal our stuff from Mac. And you actually use them, which was kind of weird, but kind of cool. Bonus points for family. Then you have to retrieve that stuff as Lightning, and ultimately challenging Chick to a Grand Prix. So you don't only get to use Lightning to play the game, which is really cool, and I thought that the variety was awesome. Variety points. Radiator Springs also gets opened up to you, allowing you to explore as much as you want. I was really impressed by how open the world was. You can drive out very freely, and I never really felt limited. Points for freedom. And the world even feels lived in. There are cars driving around shouting at you as you drive by, and even characters from the film are hanging around saying stuff, reminiscing on the movie. You can even go to Ramon's and get a paint job. I would have been cool with just Radiator Springs, but then two more sections get opened up with more activities to do. So extra points for extra sections. Driving itself does feel kind of heavy and a bit stiff. And like I said before, there's a power slide button that takes some time getting used to, but it's not bad at all. I didn't feel a lot of drag or a huge penalty for driving off the dirt. You barely lose speed, so I wanted to test how much I could actually get away with this. And yeah, you can't go too crazy. They pull you back onto the track real quick. Minus points for not letting me cheat. You obviously don't take any damage for crashing, but it would have been funny if you did. The races take place in each level, but the tracks are different. They were different enough to keep me engaged. There are shortcuts if you want to take them with jumping, and with the jumping you can catch major air. There is a monster truck race. It's kind of cool, but you really can't see where the hell you're going, so minus points for not being able to see. After completing some activities and earning enough stars, you get to race for the cups. These are 20 laps against the pros, but honestly, these were the most boring races for me because you're just going in a circle. There is a pit stop minigame with Guido to change the tires, but even with Guido, the races are pretty meh. As far as difficulty goes, it's really easy. I know, it's for kids, not for 30-year-old man children, but for the most part, I was beating everybody by at least 10 seconds. The difficulty does bump up as you go, especially in the cup. There's definitely some rubber banding there to make it a bit interesting, because if they didn't, it wouldn't have been close. I was lapping everybody at least 8 times. Voice acting is great. Lady the Cable Guy as Mater is awesome, of course. But even the new guys were pretty good and felt like part of the world. I love that they dropped in a wow.
Wow.
Extra wow points. The music is weird. Sometimes it's great, fitting the movie and using licensed songs to go with the whole vibe. But other times it doesn't fit at all. What in the Fallout Boy is going on? They're like one or two songs that are more like baseball game soundtracks than cars. Minus points for Fallout Boy. There's also multiplayer, and as a racing game, it's not bad. I wasn't expecting the whole open world stuff in the story mode, and how much effort was put in writing fun scenarios for a simple racing game to not just make it that is great. I give it a 7.25 kachows out of 10, barely beating out the movie. And finally, we have Ratatouille. Something about this movie makes me feel kind of warm. The backdrop of Paris is great, and it's a pretty unique and charming story about a rat that can cook. I give this film a nice 8.5 chef kisses out of 10. Can the game replicate that warmness? Let's find out. Asobo Studios. Why does that sound familiar? Wait a minute. No. So you're telling me the studio that's made the game about my nightmares also made this Ratatouille game? Minus points already. Or maybe bonus points because I like that game. Confused points. I wonder if the seed for a Plague Tale started right here. I don't know. I'm curious. But I was even more curious about this game as a whole because I had no idea what to expect gameplay wise. Will I just be cooking the whole time like a cooking mama or Overcooked? And I was pretty surprised to what the gameplay actually is. We start at the old lady's house as Emil is teaching us the ropes. There's platforming. He teaches us how to walk on Luxo balls. There's sprinting, which really gave me the creeps. Remy has a scent vision that guides us to the object. There will be sections where you need to go full Metal Gear Solid to hide from bigger enemies. You can tail whip to attack, but for more damage, you have to use spoon to kill enemies. I don't know why the game had me hitting these baby chicks. It made me feel so bad. You never see any baby chicks after this, so I don't know why they went so hard with baby chicks. They could have easily done the spiders or the roaches. Minus points for making me kill baby chickens. Water causes damage, so you have to avoid that, and you do that by rafting. After fleeing from the old lady, we end up in the sewers of Paris. And here's where the game kind of deviates a little from the movie. It's up to us to restore Gusto or Gusto, while at the same time help build our colony in the sewers. Story-wise, it's pretty weak. It feels like the studio didn't fully know what the story was going to be, and just got the main bits and pieces and kind of worked around that. Minus points for weak story. So each mission is to help out the colony steal food. So our objective throughout the level are to set them up for a heist that we will do at the end of the level. So you will be platforming around the level collecting items that they need to execute the plan. Once we do them all, the plan must be executed. And you do this by performing a bunch of little mini games with a timer. Once that is done, the level usually ends the same in a chase sequence that later leads down to us sliding down to the sewers where you will rinse and repeat for the next level. In every level, there are 100 stars scattered that you collect just to 100% the game. Also, there are special items you need to collect for the colony. Collect them all in each level and the colony starts to grow down in the sewers. You will see those items be put to use. I kind of like that. It made me feel like what I was doing mattered. Bonus points for making me feel important. Also, in the level, there are dream worlds. These are pretty wild platforming levels based on foods. Remy smells the food and gets high, I guess. And these can be tricky at times and get wilder and wilder as the game goes. The creativity is really shown in these levels and they're probably the highlight of the game. Points for making me hungry. Remy takes damage, but there are no lives and no game overs except for in these dream levels. So if you die, you're just taken out of the dream world, but you keep the stars you've collected. These levels are so colorful and the game as a whole looks pretty good, even with me playing the older gen version on the GameCube. So for that, good looking points. After each mission, you get even more points that you use at the main menu to buy your typical movie extras, movies, concept art, commercials, etc. The cooking kind of comes in when Linguini does. There's a level or two in the kitchen where, along with helping out the colony, at the same time you must help Linguini cook. And you do this also with minigames. There's a lot of minigames, but they're essentially the same thing. Press the button Remy tells you, press the combo in the correct order, basically just press the button on screen. The cooking doesn't really go that hard though, I wish that they did a little bit more. And it's points for the lack of cooking. Some of the music is great, it does have the movie in Paris vibes, and I appreciate the actors who reprised their role for the game. Ultimately the game was fun and better than I expected. I give it a 7.5 chef kisses out of 10, getting pretty close, but ultimately failing to replicate the taste of the movie. So, if you can count, you will notice I actually played 7 games instead of 5, just for you. So just like I went the extra mile for you, if you can return me the favor by liking, sharing, and subscribing to the channel, I would greatly appreciate it. Also, let me know down in the comments what other Pixar games I can play for a part 2. There are a lot out there. Thank you guys for watching, and remember, to always and forever, you do you.